Let's go ahead and get started. We have communion today, so I encourage you to be preparing your hearts for that time. We're few, as I said, few and far between, but the middle section is holding up well, so thank you. You guys are really putting the effort in. Father, thank you for today. Lord, we are looking forward to worshiping you, to being together with your people. Just enjoying that fellowship that you provide, because you indwell each one of us, and it's just a beautiful experience. Lord, have your way today. Be glorified in the midst of your people. Lead us and guide us. And Lord, we are looking forward to the Lord's table today, to your grace, that you just continue to pour out grace upon grace as we come in obedience to the table and seek your face. We thank you for the elements that you provide, O God, that you provided eternally in the Spirit. So, Father, have your way today as we worship you and continue on through the service. In Jesus' name, they all said, amen.
Amen.
All right. Hallelujah. Well, you got to sing loud when you don't have that many people.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God. Hosanna in the highest. Oh, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God. Glory to the King of Kings, Hosanna. Lord, we be exalted, O Lord, my God. Hosanna in the high. Hosanna in the high. Hosanna in the highest.
Amen. The Lord is good and worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. The cross is the central figure of our faith. We look to the cross for the atoning work that the Lord Jesus Christ completed, that can bring us into the very presence of God, into his kingdom, through the shed blood of the Son of God. And so we continue to always look to the cross. Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin and I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Glory to, sing it out. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus, that within, there at the cross where he took me in. Glory to his name. Oh, precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Purge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Amen. Man, we can be praising God forever and ever. All sorts of things. Hallelujah. He is good. The grace of God. What can you say? The grace of God. He didn't have to save anyone. You realize he doesn't need us. I know for us, you know, Americans, that's really tough to accept. But God didn't need people. He chose us. His grace is poured out on those that he has chosen from before the foundation of the world, that he might show himself just and righteous and merciful on those that he saves. But it's his grace. It's all him. It's nothing we do. We have no part in that. Yeah, we have to exercise faith when it comes to placing our faith in Jesus Christ and what he's done on the cross, but even that's a gift, gift of faith. God provides that, and then we exercise it. But it's the grace of God, and it's enough. Remember when Paul said, I prayed three times, O Lord, remove this messenger from Satan that's afflicting me. We're not sure what that was. If it was some people giving him trouble, whether it was a physical affliction, whether it was his eyes, you know, other things. We're not sure what that was, but the answer is, my grace is sufficient for you. You don't always get what you pray for, do you? Oh, God, deliver me from this messenger of Satan. He said, no. Stand up, son. My grace is sufficient for you. I'll get you through it. You'll have victory in it, but you're going to have to trust in my grace. Trust me, oh, God. You know, he's constantly asking us to trust him. Trust and obey. For there's no other way, right? Because his grace is enough for everything you need. Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. Lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Let's sing that again. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Great is your love and justice, God of Jacob. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along. Remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for. Yeah, your grace is enough. Heaven reaches out to us. Your grace is enough for me. God, I sing your grace is enough. I'm covered in your love. Your grace is enough for me, for me. His grace is enough. Hallelujah. He's all around us. His grace covers us. As the psalmist would say, it's like he's a shield about us. Thou, O Lord, art a shield about me. You're my glory. You're the lifter of my head. Thou, sing out. Hallelujah, you're the living. I come boldly to your throne, thirsting, longing for your presence alone. As we prepare to come to the table, pray and thank God for all that he's done on the cross, through the resurrection, through the pouring out of his Spirit that he might indwell us, that that might be a confirmation of our salvation, who we are, all this that he has provided. If you feel that you've got some issues you should be taking care of, then I invite you to take care of them in prayer. Take care of them in prayer. Judge the body rightly. Maybe you got a problem with someone in the body. That's fine. Take care of it. You know, God's the God that forgives. He shed his blood. He poured out his grace. And so as we come to the table today, come expecting to meet him, to receive of his grace, to have it poured out upon you. His forgiveness constantly poured out through Christ Jesus. It's your blood that cleanses me. It's your blood that gives me life. It's your blood that took my place in redeeming sacrifice and washes me. Whiter than the snow, my Jesus, God's precious sacrifice. It's your blood that cleanses me. It's your blood that gives me life. It's your blood. Redeeming sacrifice washes me. Whiter than the snow. In the snow, my Jesus, God's precious sacrifice. Let's take some time to pray. Thank you. once more.
It's your blood that cleanses me. It's your blood that gives me life. It's your blood that took my place in redeeming sacrifice. Washes me. Whiter than the snow, than the snow. My Jesus, God's precious
sacrifice. For devotion, before communion, we take communion, I'd like to read one of the prayers of the Puritans, as I've been doing. I really enjoy the depth of their spiritual lives and how they shared that. And so we have it today, which is a great thing. It's always nice to see how deep the depth of people's growth when they don't have Game Boys and telephones and television and movies and everything else under the sun that keeps us distracted from the things of God. And you can see that they were dealing with this stuff on a daily basis. So this one goes like this, and then we'll take the bread and the cup. Lord Jesus, I am blind, but thou my light. Ignorant, be thou my wisdom. Self-willed, be thou my mind. Open my ear to grasp quickly thy Spirit's voice and delightfully run after his beckoning hand. Melt my conscience that no hardness remain. Make it alive to evil's slightest touch. When Satan approaches, may I flee to thy wounds and there cease to tremble at all alarms. Be my good shepherd to lead me into the green pastures of thy word and cause me to lie down beside the rivers of its comforts. Fill me with peace, that no disquieting worldly gales may ruffle the calm surface of my soul. Thy cross was upraised to be my refuge. Thy blood streamed forth to wash me clean. Thy death occurred to give me a surety. Thy name is my property to save me. By thee, all heaven is poured into my heart. But it is too narrow to comprehend thy love. I was a stranger, an outcast, a slave, a rebel, but thy cross has brought me near, has softened my heart, has made me thy father's child.
has admitted me to thy family, has made me joint heir with thyself. Oh, that I may love thee as thou lovest me, that I may walk worthy of thee, my Lord, that I may reflect the image of heaven's firstborn. May I always see thy beauty with the clear eye of faith and feel the power of thy spirit in my heart. For unless he move mightily in me, no inward fire will be kindled. Father, we thank you for the prayer of your servant here so long ago, as it ministers to our heart and speaks of our great need for you. But we come in thanksgiving. We come today to come to the table as you commanded. We come to take up the bread, symbol of your broken body, for us. By your stripes we are healed. And we come to take the cup, your blood, the cup of the new covenant, poured out for us. We have everything to gain by coming to the table. You are here, and your grace is indeed sufficient. It is enough for us. And so, Lord, hear our cry as we prepare our hearts to come forward, to partake of the elements, and to glorify your name. Have your way, O Lord, in us, that you might be glorified. And they all said, amen. Invite you when you're ready. The deacons, if they would come forward, we've got one at this table and one over here to watch over the elements for you and to greet you as you come up. And when you're ready, come up and, as always, form some prayer groups, pray for one another, and someone in the group then lead in the eating of the bread and the drinking of the cup. There we go. Well, as I said last week, I was taking a little bit of a break from Revelation. I like to get into some narrative type preaching. Acts really supplies that. You got a storyline. You're going linearly. It's pretty good. But a lot of the things that we learned in the book of Revelation, we're up in chapter 17 now, they make a lot more sense. Or I should say, Acts will make a lot more sense now that you know those things. And so that's why I wanted to do that. And, of course, give you a little bit of a break from Revelation. It can get a little oppressive when you keep talking about persecution of the saints. You know, let's talk about some positive things here for a little bit. Not that persecution isn't positive. It's just not fun. All right, we're going to be talking about Cornelius, the Roman centurion. We're going to be talking about Peter, God's man of the hour. In Acts chapter 10, we already saw Paul, or Saul of Tarsus, had been converted, and we talked about that last time. I want to take a look at this incident where Peter, the great fisherman, the great apostle, goes to Caesarea to encounter, by God's command, Cornelius, a Roman soldier who happens to obviously be a Gentile. Now, the promise of the Father. We remember in Acts chapter 1 that Jesus was talking about that. You wait here until the promise of the Father has come upon you. The promise of the Father is what we find in Ezekiel chapter 36, where God says, I will give them a new heart. I will wash them clean with water, and I will give them a new heart. And on that heart, my laws will be written in a soft heart that's pliable, that I can work with. He's talking about being born again. Ezekiel 36 is about regeneration, which is the fancy word for being born again. Okay, coming out of your sins, out of your old lifestyle, and into the kingdom of God. Out of the kingdom of darkness in which we all showed up on this planet, but instead translated, transferred into the kingdom of light, being born again, regenerated. It's the coming of the Holy Spirit to indwell believers. That's the fulfillment of that Old Testament prophecy. When he's saying, I will wash them clean and I will give them a new heart, he says, I will put my spirit within them. That is the promise of Christ in you, the hope of glory, the Holy Spirit dwelling in you. That's what they were waiting for. The Holy Spirit indwelling a believer is the promise of the Father. It is a seal. It is a confirmation that you are saved, you are born again, and that your destiny is assured. You're going to go to be with Him forever because you belong to Him. And you don't have to worry about losing that salvation because you didn't get it on your own anyways. It's something God has done in you. And He will make sure that you hold on to that all the way to the end. Perseverance of the saints or preservation of the saints, depending on which word you prefer, He will keep, take care of you to the end. Once you're born again, you can't be unborned again. Do we understand? The cleansing water, the new heart, the indwelling spirit, that is the new covenant. Regeneration. When Jesus said, this cup, this, you know, is my blood of the new covenant, He was confirming that the prophecy of Ezekiel was coming to pass. That's why He said, wait. Since that was over and He rose from the dead, wait till the coming of the promise of the Father. You just wait. It's coming. If you look at Ezekiel, if you want to, as you read on your own, you've got that going on, regeneration, in chapter 36. But in 37 is the famous story about the Valley of the Dry Bones, right? The prophecy of the Valley of the Dry Bones. That's an illustration that God put together to explain what regeneration is. That which was dead now lives. That's why it's right after that. We've separated into just one neat little story, you know, them bones, them dry bones, and we do that, and we preach that, and we teach it in Sunday school. And all that. That is the confirmation of chapter 36. Will these bones live? Oh, man. Only you know, God. I don't want to answer that, but you know. You know, He says, yeah, you watch this. And then sinews begin to go on. We see these bones rise up, dead, dry. Isn't that what we were when we were unsaved? Well, we might have been sweet and nice and all that kind of stuff, but we were dead as dead could be, dry bones. But God has made those bones live. The promise of the Father. And of course, Jesus told His disciples to wait for this promise in Acts 1, 4 through 5. And He said, while staying with them, He ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which He said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will, and the baptized here is being used in the concept, the concern of being immersed into, okay? Drown in, soaked in, till every fiber, it's a launderer's term. It's what they did when they took cloth and put it into purple dye. And they put it down until every fiber was saturated with purple dye. The word is, they baptized it. And that's what God does with you. Christ in you. You're saturated with Him. The hope of glory. Of course, Christ in you is the Holy Spirit dwelling there. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized, immersed, saturated, soaked in the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Now, God is doing something very interesting. He's doing it in stages. Bang, bang, bang. And then we've taken that for granted. We just kind of call it evangelism, and we do this, and we see people come to Christ and all that kind of stuff. That's wonderful. That's how it works. But in the beginning, God unfolded that step by step so they would all see that He kept His promise from the Old Testament. And this is how He did it. It's the promised immersion or empowerment to be God's witnesses via the Holy Spirit. You're His witnesses. He called you to be His witnesses, to declare His glory. The Holy Spirit is the confirmation and seal that we are the children of God, saved through grace and by faith in the atoning work of Jesus Christ. The book of Acts is the story of the initial advance of God's kingdom from Jerusalem to the end of the earth. The point of Acts chapter 1 verse 8 is that the coming Holy Spirit is not only the confirmation and seal of God's great salvation to those who believe, but it is also how God will advance His kingdom in stages from Jewish Jerusalem and Judea to Samaria and then to the uttermost parts of the earth, the Gentiles. What you're looking at is how the book of Acts is a story of how God fulfills this. He said, Pentecost, where were they at? In Jerusalem, right? You shall be my witnesses in both Jerusalem, Judea, kind of surrounding area, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. You see that developed in Acts. First in Jerusalem, the day of Pentecost. Who were there? Jews from every nation, because it was Pentecost. They had come in from everywhere, representing all the nations. And when they were gathered together, what happened? Mighty rushing wind. All of a sudden, whoosh, the Holy Spirit shows up. And they began to declare God's glory in foreign languages. It wasn't a prayer language like some people teach. That was not it. That's another issue. You can talk about that in another context. This was the declaration in languages that people understood because they were all there. And all of them are hearing from the nations, are hearing about the glory of God in their own languages. They were getting it. The Holy Spirit had showed up, the promise of the Father. He said, wait, and it will hit. It'll come. It's promised. And so we see that happening first stage where? In Jerusalem. You should be my witnesses in both Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, Acts chapter 8. Who are the Samaritans? Half-breeds. If you watch old cowboy movies, that's a famous word, right? Half-breeds. They were originally Jewish, but they were pulled out of there and transported all across the world by conquering groups, Assyria and Babylon, but Assyria especially. You know, that's what they did. They took conquered peoples, lifted them up, and threw them somewhere else. And then they'd bring people they conquered over here and bring them into here. That way, nobody understood what each other was saying. Their cultures were different. Their traditions were different. They just couldn't get it together to rebel against the Assyrian king. Very smart strategy if you're going to go around conquering people. But the Samaritans were partly Jewish, but they represented peoples from all the nations. You have no idea who they were. That's why the Jews hated them so much. Talk about a bigoted group of people. It was the Jews in Old and New Testament times. Ooh, they hated Gentiles. Called them dogs. This had been bred into them from Abraham. But not from him specifically, but from the time of Abraham. They had developed this attitude of bigotry towards anyone who wasn't one of them. What is God doing? First, in Jerusalem. Why? Because salvation is of the Jews. Told them that. And he went there first. Promise of the Father. Bam! People from every nation are hearing it. Whoa. What's next? Well, they were told to get out and be his witnesses. They were told to go forth and to preach the gospel and to teach people and make them disciples. People from all the nations. Nations in the Bible means people groups. It doesn't mean Canada, United States, Mexico. That's not what it means when it says nations. It means different people groups. Those who speak this language. And those that might speak this. You see, there's nothing about the borders that we usually see on a map. That had nothing to do with it. People groups, they're the nations. They have different traditions, different cultures, but they all get together. They understand each other in this group. But they don't know much about this group over here. That's another nation. And then there's another one here. So that's what he's saying. You're going to go and disciple all the nations. You know what they did? Nothing! They stayed in Jerusalem and enjoyed the party. Guess what God did? He raised up persecution. They hightailed it out of Jerusalem as fast as they could get, except for a few of the church leaders who stayed, you know, James and some of those guys. But everybody else, off they go, because this persecution's deadly. You know where they ended up? Samaria. You shall be my witnesses in both Jerusalem and Judea, which is the same area. Samaria. And the uttermost parts of the earth. Do you see what God's doing? This is just classic. This is so good. He said, you're going to be my witnesses in every people group that there is, all the way from here, the Jewish people, all the way to all of the Gentiles, to the ends of the earth. But in the process, I'm going to make you stop in Samaria. You know, the people you hate that you don't want to deal with? I'm going to make you stop there. And I'm going to make you be my witnesses there. And I'm going to pour out my spirit on them. Now, if you were a decent Jew, that's offensive. That really makes you mad. In fact, Jesus said stuff like that all the time. He went to Gentile places all the time. Guess what he got? Persecution. They hated him. They didn't like him. They made fun of him. They said this and that. What self-respecting teacher of Israel would go into the Samaritan regions and talk to them? Remember the woman at the well? She was a Samaritan. They were in Samaria. You know where all the disciples were? They were in town together. They were afraid. They're in enemy territory. They don't like being there. So they all went to the Circle K together. Meanwhile, Jesus has a divine appointment with not only a Samaritan who his disciples did not want to deal with. Are you ready for it? Like, ooh, he was a Samaritan woman. Ooh. You see what God's doing? He's breaking it down. Breaking it down. Breaking down their prejudices, their bigotry, their religious, you know, attitudes. He's just breaking it. Why? Because he's going into all the nations. He knows who he saved. He knows from before the foundation of the earth those who belong to him. And he's going to get the job done. They're going to go from Jerusalem to the uttermost parts of the earth. And you're going to do it quietly, in obedience, or I'll drag you screaming. Now, I'm paraphrasing, but that's what happened. They wouldn't go to Samaria on their own, so he raised up persecution in Jerusalem, and off they went. Woo, 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 off they go. And all of a sudden, guess what happened? I'm not going into Acts chapter 8 today, but the Holy Spirit showed up. Same thing. And they're all declaring the glory of God. They all heard the word, and they became saved. So God says, all right, now we poured it out there, just like I said. Samaria was next. But where is he going next? To the uttermost parts of the earth. Well, how do you do that? Who are we talking about? We're talking about the Gentiles. All the non-Jews, if you need a phrase. Well, they didn't want to do that either. You know, it was unlawful for a Jewish man to go into a Gentile's home. You weren't supposed to do that kind of stuff because they're yucky. They got cooties. You don't go there. Okay, and any self-respecting Jew, that's what the whole story of Cornelius is so exciting. Peter, when he finally shows up, he says, oh, hi. They do a little meet and greet. And he says, all right, let me start talking. Let me start having this cross-cultural Bible study, the first one that ever existed. Listen to me. He says, you know, it's not right for me, a Jewish man, to be in this place. And they're all going, oh, yeah, yeah. You know, you think you're that and all bag of chips. You're all that. Yeah, we get it. But he said, God, and this is where we're going. He said, God convinced me I was wrong. I was a chump. I was an idiot. And let's get into that. The Cornelius encounter. You shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea, in Samaria, and to the end of the earth. See, the story of Cornelius is God's third stage of pouring out his Holy Spirit. It's on the Gentiles. Just like he said, and after that, it's one continuous thing. But he went in stages, which I find fascinating. And I think he may have had to do that for his people's sake. I don't know why. I just know it's clear. That's what he did. And so we'll look at that as we go along. From Jerusalem to Samaria and on to Caesarea, Luke recounts God's strategic outpouring of his Spirit on all mankind, to the Jew first, then through the mixed Samaritans, and ultimately to the Gentile world. The vision of unclean animals and the conversion of the Gentile Cornelius, which we're going to get into, is significant in God's evangelistic story. The gospel advanced from Jerusalem to Judea and into Samaria via the Samaritan revival, as we talked about in Acts 8. Now, God is fulfilling His promise to advance His kingdom into the Gentile world through a Roman soldier in a significant Gentile city, Caesarea. The confrontation with Peter, exposing his ethnic and religious bigotry, is an example of how God's eternal purpose to call people into His kingdom from every tribe, language, people, and nation. It's the confirmation of what we saw in Revelation chapter 5. They're all around the throne praising God. It's a vision. This is what's going on in heaven. They're all around the throne praising God, and there are people there from every nation, tribe, people, and language. Is God a racist? No, He is not. Is God a bigot? No, He is not. He's got people from every walk of life, from every nation on the face of the earth, coming into His kingdom. So when God's people start acting a little bit exclusive, He'll break that door down, because that's not His plan. So we're in disobedience when we act that way. Let's look at point one. God contacts the Gentile Cornelius. This is Acts chapter 10, beginning with verse 1. I'll read it. At Caesarea there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion of what was known as the Italian cohort, a devout man who feared God with all his household, gave alms generously to the people, and he prayed continually to God. This guy's a Gentile. But he's a God-fearer. He's seeking God. He loves the monotheistic religion of the Jewish people. He's been stationed in Caesarea. He's aware of all this that's going on. And he's sympathetic to that whole situation. He gives alms and gifts to the Jewish people who are in need. They all recognized it. They love this guy. And he was constantly praying, seeking God's face. Guess what? God shows up when someone's seeking His face. You can count on that. About the ninth hour, that's 3 p.m., of the day, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God come in and say to him, Cornelius, and he stared at him in terror and said, what is it, Lord? And he said to him, your prayers and your alms have ascended as a memorial before God. Wouldn't you like that said of you? Oh, wow, what an attaboy. And now send men to Joppa, it's 30 miles down the coast, and bring one Simon, who is called Peter. He's lodging with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea. When the angel who spoke to him had departed, he, that's Cornelius, called two of his servants and a devout soldier from among those who attended him. And having related everything to them, told them all that just happened, he sent them to Joppa to go pick up the great fisherman Peter. Go get him. Let's look at the character of Cornelius. Why is God selecting him? Well, you know, God's God. He does what He does. But we get a lot of a description of what this guy is like. And I find it fascinating, because God is looking for His third stage to be fulfilled, and He picks Cornelius, a Roman centurion. You got to love it. You know, in the Bible, whenever a centurion is mentioned, it's always in a positive light. Go back and look. Kind of like sergeants in a sense, though you can't figure out Roman hierarchy of rank. It's really difficult and fuzzy. But they're kind of like non-coms. They do all the work. And the men respect them and love them and all that. That's what these centurions are like. You know, they understand order. They understand obedience. They understand taking, you know, orders and doing these kind of things. And so whenever you see them in the Scriptures, it's always in a positive light. They're doing something right. The Roman centurion, Cornelius, he's an interesting player in God's purpose to pour out His Spirit from Jerusalem to the ends of the earth. Cornelius the Gentile. He's part of the Italian cohort. It's a famous group
of Roman soldiers, legionnaires, which had previously been moved to Syria. They weren't in Italy anymore. They were stationed in Syria. He most likely was a member of the auxiliary troops that were recruited from the Gentile provinces. Some of the thinking on this, he wasn't even really a Roman by birth. But he was in the Roman legion because Rome conquered everything, and they would take from the provinces those who wanted to be Roman citizens, Roman soldiers, wanted to be a part of that. This may be one of those guys, still a Gentile. I mean, way out there, right? A Gentile. And God selected him. I call him a Micah 6:8 Gentile. What's Micah 6:8? He has told you, O man, what is good. To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with the Lord your God. That's how this guy strikes me. Now, he's not born again yet, I get all that, but this is the kind of guy he is. Giving alms to the Jewish people, being kind, seeking God's face constantly, walking humbly with God. He was a God-fearer, that's a term the Jews used about people from other cultures that worshipped Yahweh, but really didn't want to go through the whole circumcision route. Which we all understand, right, guys? He loved the monotheistic religion of the Jews, and as a typical Roman, Cornelius had been exposed to the whole pantheon of Roman gods, you know, from Mars to this, to the, every one of those, August, you know, they're all over the place. He found them to be false. Therefore, he honored the God of the Jews and worshipped him. And of course, he gave offerings to help the people in need. Cornelius and his family, they were respected by the Jewish population. Cornelius' heart was sincere and submissive, but he still needed to be saved through the cleansing blood of Jesus. No one comes to Christ unless the Father draws him. And Cornelius was being drawn to Christ so that he might respond to the gospel call when it came. While God was preparing Cornelius' heart to respond to the gospel, guess what else he was doing? At the same time, he was preparing Peter's heart, as we shall see, to proclaim the gospel to a Gentile. That's my Jewish impression. They did do that. So we see his character. What about his obedience? It's 3 p.m. He's in prayer. He's seeking God's face at 3 p.m. We're usually drinking coffee and trying not to take a nap, right? This guy's seeking God. He has a vision. And so then he tells, in obedience to the vision, he tells three men to go to Joppa and fetch Peter. He's lodging with Simon the tanner. And of course, that's 30 miles down the coast. That's not too bad. That's a two-day journey if you're walking. So Cornelius obeys God's messenger and dispatches three men to go find Peter. You see, God has already put in motion the opportunity for Cornelius and his household to experience God's salvation. It's already underway. Cornelius doesn't know that, just like we don't know. But while you're seeking God and spending time in prayer, God's working on your behalf. He's preparing things way in advance so that when we finally pray about them, it's because he's initiating that prayer. Say, go ahead and pray for this because I'm going to give it to you. And so we join him in what he's doing. It's an opportunity for us here to see that God is continually arranging divine appointments for his children. That's what he does. We're talking about you. What you're reading here in the scriptures is about you. That God's always preparing to bless you and to answer prayer and to prepare you to be his disciples, his servants. The factors that brought everything together were God's elective purpose, and it's combined with the prayers and obedience of someone responding to the gospel. God is continually at work, arranging our lives to be a glorious testimony to him. You're supposed to be, I'm supposed to be, we are testimonies to the living God. That's why we're here. The question is, are we cooperating? Are we focused on God's will being done? Do our prayers ascend?
as a memorial before God? Well, let's look at our second point. You see, Cornelius has now received a contact from God himself. And he tells him, now you go and contact this guy. I got a guy. I got a guy in Joppa. Go get him. In Acts 10, beginning with verse 9, we read this. The next day, as those three guys were on their journey and approaching the city of Joppa, Peter went up on the housetop, went up on the housetop about the sixth hour to pray. Wait a minute. Cornelius is praying and God's contacting him. Peter's going up there to pray on the top of the roof. You can see the ocean, the Mediterranean, probably a beautiful view. He's going up there to pray and God's going to contact him. Meanwhile, while he's praying and waiting for lunch, he becomes hungry and he wanted something to eat. But while they were preparing it, he fell into a trance. It's a spirit-induced, ecstatic situation. He's seeing a vision. It's just like happened to Cornelius. And he saw the heavens opened and something like a great sheet descending, being let down by its four corners upon the earth. And in it were all kinds of animals and reptiles and birds of the air. Well, in this sheet, in this vision, are animals, clean and unclean, of all kinds, mixed, squirming together. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." I'm sure that PETA doesn't like this verse. "Arise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "Well, by no means, Lord." You got to love this. God tells you to do something, you say, "Oh, no way, Jose." "By no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." The word is profane. That which is not clean, ceremonially clean and purified, that you have allowed. And the voice came to him again a second time. "What God has made clean, do not call common." And this happened three times, and the thing then was taken up at once to heaven. So, Cornelius' men are on their way to Joppa. Meanwhile, Peter's praying on the rooftop around noon. He's hungry, and lunch is still being prepared. And then he goes into this trance, walking right into God's ambush. I like the little subtleties here. It's noon. He's hungry. He has a vision. "Arise, Peter, kill and eat." "Well, at that time, I'm ready to kill anything. I'm hungry." "Oh, no. Oh, no, Lord. No." Three times, no. Peter states his lifelong adherence to the Jewish dietary laws, even though Jesus had already declared all foods clean in Mark 7. That had to be done so that the Jew and the Gentile could come together in fellowship at the table. There's a lot behind all of that. Jesus' point was that it's not what a man eats that makes him unclean, but what comes out of his heart. That's what defiles him. And here, Peter's heart is defiling him. God is exposing Peter for who he is, to Peter. Peter's heart is full of ethnic and religious hatred for Gentiles. And I find this amusing. As God had Peter busy with ministry in Gentile locations, Lydda and Joppa, right before he got him here, he was sending him into places he normally wouldn't have gone, Gentile regions. And he was ministering. Aeneas, rise up and walk. And I think it was Lydia that he raised from the dead. Two things he saw Jesus do. And if you look back, you'll see that they're almost word for word. He was copying the master. And so God has him doing all these. You know, he was kind of puffed up, right? Feeling pretty good. Look how God's using me. He's using me supernaturally. People are getting healed and all that stuff. He had to have been feeling pretty good about himself. Peter's acting like the prophet Jonah, though. He's actually an unclean animal being led to the slaughter. And he has no idea what God is about to do. He's very much like Jonah. Jonah's a prophet of God. That's pretty high rank, right? Prophet of God. He disobeyed God rather than see God's mercy and forgiveness extended to the pagan Ninevites, the Gentiles. Jonah took off from God the other way. Wasn't going to do it. And that's not a good position to take following the giving of the Great Commission. See, Peter's really in a fix now. He doesn't want to deal with Gentiles, but he's still in his ear. He's hearing the echo. You shall be my witnesses, you know, all the way to the ends of the earth. You shall make disciples of all the nations, the Great Commission. How's he dealing with this? He's in chess, we call it, he's in a fork. No matter which direction he goes, he's dead. He can't do anything. God's got him right where he wants him. God ever done that to you? He's done that to me. Oh, yeah, yeah, that feels great, doesn't it? I think I'm just going to have to submit and obey God. Darn, that was the last thing I wanted to do. You see, Jesus is a command to make disciples of all nations. That seems to have gotten lost in the translation somewhere. You see, everything's all fun and games until someone has to witness to a Gentile. They were all ready to do God's work. They're ready to go out. They're ready to do this, but wait, whoa, stop. Slow down here. We're going out of our comfort zone, and we got to witness to people that we've considered dogs all of our lives. What's going on here? Well, God, what are you doing? You know, in Peter's day, Jewish midwives were forbidden to help a Gentile woman in childbirth because it would bring more Gentile scum into the world. This is the bigotry we're talking about. There was, we think we understand bigotry and prejudice. And all, we're pikers compared to what was going on here. There was some intense despisement. This bigoted attitude toward Gentiles was seared into Jewish thought and behavior. Jews called the Gentiles goyim, which means translated the nations. They didn't want anything to do with the nations. But here Jesus says, I want you to go into all the nations and make disciples. Ooh, ouch, what do you do now? This attitude even permeated the early Hebrew Christian community, making Jesus' command to go to the nations a stumbling block. And here we see it. He's stumbling over this. He doesn't know what to do with this. The four corners of the sheet represent the four points of the compass on the earth. The assorted clean and unclean animals represent all the people of the earth squirming in blindness to the gospel. Wow, what a vision. The irony is thick. Peter is staying at a Jewish tanner's house, which was considered unclean to a fastidious Jew worried about keeping the law. Tanners were Jews. I mean, this Simon was a Jew, but he was a Jewish tanner, and tanners were considered like yuck. You don't get around them. If the whole thing's unclean, it's nasty, it's disgusting. So here Peter is, a fastidious Jew about clean and unclean foods and all, but he's staying with Simon. He's a complicated, convicted, conflicted individual. He doesn't know if he's coming or going, and God's got him right where he wants him. This is great. Rabbinical law stated that a betrothed woman could break her engagement if she later found out her fiancé was involved in a tanning business. She must have been confused, thought he owned a tanning salon. Because that would have been acceptable, right? Apparently, Peter cannot understand something unless it's presented to him three times. You ever notice that? You ever picked up on that? Three denials of Jesus, right? No, I don't know him. I don't know him. Three commands to get back to his calling. Do you love me? Do you love me? You know, Lord, you know. Do you love me? Three times. And here we are. Three commands to not call unclean what God has made clean. This statement right there. I mean, if you boiled it all down to that, God's saying, rise, Peter, kill and eat. He said, I've never done anything like that. I won't eat anything unclean. And then God says, don't you ever dare to call unclean what I have made clean. He's talking about people. He's getting through to Peter, though. It's happening. He's a hard-headed fisherman. But it was coming to fruition. You know, Mahatma Gandhi shared in his autobiography that in his student days in England, he was deeply touched by reading the Gospels and seriously considered becoming a convert to Christianity, which seemed to offer a real solution to the caste system that divided the people of India. In one Sunday, he attended church services and decided to ask the minister for enlightenment on salvation and other doctrines. But when Gandhi entered the sanctuary, the ushers refused to give him a seat, and they suggested that he go elsewhere to worship with his own people. He left. I'm remembering something. He left and never came back. He thought to himself, if Christians have caste differences also, I might as well remain a Hindu. I witnessed and addressed this exact situation, and it was in an on-fire evangelistic church in Mississippi. It was an ambush from God. It's one of those deals. Now, these folks loved the Lord. They were very much into evangelism. I mean, big time. And they loved the Lord. They did. But they had a caste system in place. After questioning their chief deacon, which I could do because I was a visitor from Arizona, so nobody cared what I thought. After questioning their chief deacon, which I did because I heard him say some things that really were questionable, I found out that certain individuals of their community attempting to visit this church would be politely steered toward other churches where they might feel more comfortable. Now, I'm not going to go into the whole story about that. Someday, I've told it before, and maybe if you ask me, I'll tell you. God was not happy. Not happy at all. Later, he tore that thing down. And he had told me to tell them that. Like Peter, we harbor unacceptable attitudes, even while generally being in fellowship with Christ. See, Peter was praying when he had his vision. He was being spiritual. He was seeking God's will regarding his life and his ministry. Stuff we all do all the time, amen? Yeah, he loved the Lord, obviously. He had a beautiful attitude toward God, but he had a very lousy attitude toward the world. This biblical text has much to say to us as it did to Peter and the apostles. The stakes are just as high today. How we look at the lost souls around us is crucial. Why? Because God said, I want you to go out to all the nations and make disciples. He never said anything, I want you to just find out how I can make you really happy. Well, that sells, but that's not what he said. Okay, that's just a satanic doctrine. Now, you might want to hold on here. Don't kill me yet. We can hate our government's liberal border policies because of the danger it poses for a safe and ordered society, correct? You can hate the policies. We can despise the coyotes who take advantage of poor pilgrims and prosper from kidnapping and sex trafficking. Such righteous indignation is biblically legitimate because that's evil stuff going on. However, to despise and hate the poor sojourner, the alien, seeking a better life will run you straight into the God who cares for them. You will find yourself opposed to God. You can hate the politics. You can hate the administration that's in power because of the evil that they do. But people are a different story. The alien, the sojourner, the widow, the orphan. God cares for those. I gave you some scriptures you can look up if you don't believe me. It has been said in missional theology, the study of missions, if you won't go to them with the gospel, God will bring them to you. Now you put that in place. If you won't go to them with the gospel,
God will bring them to you.
Historically, that's very accurate. And yes, God can put godless political parties in power to reveal this truth to you. Something to think about when our politics overrule our gospel mandate. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and without the indwelling Spirit confirming our salvation through our faith in Christ, we're no different than any other sinner. God knows all those who have been appointed unto salvation. We don't know who they are. We're just called to go out and witness about Jesus. Therefore, no one is unclean to us, but all are in need of salvation. This does not mean we put up with unclean or ungodly belief systems, which is happening all around us in our government, and unclean, ungodly behavior, which is going on every time you turn the TV, right? Transgenderism and the marching and this and that. Sin just on parade. You don't have to agree with that. You better not agree with that, because that's sin. But we're still subject to the law of God. The law of God, by the way, is His character. This is why the apostles had no patience for false teachers and those who would corrupt the body of Christ. If you go and read through the epistles, you do a little reading about Christian history, the apostles, they witnessed, after they got this message with Cornelius, after they figured this out and they started going into all the world, which they did, okay, but they didn't put up with any of this garbage in the church. When somebody would come in the church and try and corrupt it, false teachers, they went after them fast. They went after them hard, because that's not allowed. You don't allow that garbage in your fellowship. See, that's a different situation, and it demands constant attention to the health of the body of Christ. Peter here, though, is a racist bigot, despising those outside Judaism. He is in disobedience to the Great Commission that was proclaimed by his master. Later on, a little fun fact there, Peter's going to understand all this from this vision and what God did with him and all that, and he gets it, and I left you some scriptures there. But as we finish up, the last portion of this, the Holy Spirit contacts the Gentiles. Acts 10:44, while Peter was still saying these things, like, I will not, or he's gone to Cornelius' house, excuse me. I left a whole bunch out because it's too long, but you know the thing. Peter agrees to go. So he goes with the men, and they go to Caesarea. He walks up to Cornelius' house. Can you imagine this? He's not allowed in the house as a fastidious Jew. Knock, knock, knock. He comes in. Little meet and greet. Hi, I'm Peter. You know, this, that, blah, 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 blah. And then he starts his little speech, and he says, you all know that it is not lawful for me to be in this room with you. And they all knew it. But he says, God has showed me something. He's taught me a lesson, and I'm here. And he begins to proclaim the Lord Jesus Christ in salvation to all these people. And while he's doing that, guess what happens? Whoosh! The Holy Spirit shows up, and they begin to speak in other languages, languages that they all understood, glorifying God. It was the confirmation of the indwelling Holy Spirit coming to the Gentiles. Boom! Just like happened in Jerusalem. You know why that's important? Because the Jews and the Gentiles needed to know they were both on the same spiritual footing. That's why God did it that way. While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed. In other words, his Jewish buddies that were accompanying him were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. Surprise, surprise, but God had already told them this was coming. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, can anyone withhold water for baptizing his people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And they asked him to remain for several days. Peter and company have arrived at Cornelius' house in Caesarea. And as I told you, after all the greetings, the The Holy Spirit just goes, go wham. The Jews accompanying Peter, amazed that the promise of the Father was poured out on the Gentiles, and with the sign manifestation of speaking in foreign languages, extolling the glory of God. And that is a sign that God's indwelling Spirit is being poured out on all the nations, all the people groups. That's why it's different than a prayer language. So you want to have that discussion, you can. That's somewhere else. That's why they were all proclaiming and extolling God in languages that everybody else understood. It was the sign that God was sending the gospel to the nations. Since these Gentile believers in Cornelius' house had received into the new covenant through the atoning work of Christ and confirmed by the sealing of the Holy Spirit, they needed to be initiated into the church body. And how that's done is through the covenantal ordinance of water baptism. Makes you a member, and it reveals that you have desired to enter into covenant with the local body of Christ. That's why it's important. And with this event concluded, the Great Commission could go out to all four corners of the earth. As we know, as we read the book of Acts and all that, there's still going to be a few Jewish-Gentile theological bumps, but they'll iron those out as they go. But the path had been cleared for the advance of the kingdom to the ends of the earth. So in closing, both Peter the Jew and Cornelius the Gentile were seeking God's will. And Acts 10 reveals that our Heavenly Father knows what we need even before we ask. This is wonderful when we realize that He has been preparing us for His healing, deliverance, financial help, and restored relationships. He's always doing that. He's working ahead of us. And then He's calling us to pray about those things. His will is pure. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. His will is pure, true, and profitable. We praise Him for such blessings. However, when the spotlight is off our needs, we aren't so keen to obey God's mandates because our will is tainted, confused, and selfish. That was Peter. Our attitude toward the unbelieving world is supremely important to God. That's the thrust of the book of Jonah. And it was Jonah's bad attitude toward the world that landed him in the belly of the great fish. God corrected his prophet's self-will, his prejudice, and his elitism, just as he was doing with Peter. In Christ, there's no basis for discrimination of any kind. Prejudice or elitism on the lips of a believer is an obscenity, whether it be racial, national, cultural, or social. James 2:1. This is a difficult word for believers in the midst of a world gone mad. We don't even know how to operate. We don't even know what to do. It's crazy. Be advised, God is sovereign. He will accomplish His will to proclaim the gospel to the ends of the earth. And that's regardless of our selfishly perverted political and bigoted worldview. He's going to get it done. Now, we live in a divine tension. We want a society that lives by the tenets of the Bible, but we don't want to pay the price. We want the benefits of the gospel without the responsibilities of the gospel. We're a funny group, aren't we? When God's people love Him, but are working off an incorrect theological premise, God will lovingly but firmly schedule a come to Jesus meeting, as He did with the great apostle Peter. Remember, it is thy will be done, not my will be done. The Cornelius episode shook the foundations of Jewish self-understanding. Sometimes God has to do such cataclysmic things to get His people refocused and back on track to proclaiming the kingdom. You should think about that when you're discussing politics. The mandate to share the gospel overrides our politics. So be careful, or you might find yourself fighting God. Father, we thank you for your word, these instances that we see in the book of Acts, how you poured out your spirit on these three people groups and covered everybody, just as you said you were going to do. We see how you dealt with the great apostle Peter and his attitudes. Boy, that's a hard lesson for us to see, but it's so true. We thank you for it. We ask for help. Help our unbelief. We just want to be, we want to walk in truth. We're not going to compromise truth, but at the same time, we need to see things from your biblical worldview. So open up the scriptures to us so that we can see what you think about things and know how to respond. Because we are in a world gone mad, Lord. But we trust you. In Jesus' name, they all said,
amen.
Amen. You're dismissed.